We started a series last week on biblical principles for goal setting. And this is a pre-op, you might say, setting for the financial biblical seminar that I'm going to be giving. A lot of people have asked to for me to go ahead and handle budgeting from a biblical perspective, financing, and help you basically get out of debt and wrestle down your expenses to see what's going on. There's a lot of individuals that are so filled with debt that they're never going to be able to get out of it. And just one scripture says, the Bible says that the debtor is slave to the lender. And in this series, I'm also going to teach you how to reverse that. Instead of you going ahead and borrowing, putting it on a credit card, that if we can get you straightened out, we can basically make you your own banker. And if you have a credit card of $3,000, and that's what you're allowed to spend, we're going to get you to the place where you can put $3,000 in the bank. And when you want to go ahead and buy something because you're impulsive, okay, you can pay yourself interest. You can charge yourself 24%, 24.99%, okay, which is a lot of money. And most people run credit cards up, and they keep the credit cards up, and you're basically paying the minimum payment. And they've worked it out. Congress passed a law, says that now you can not just pay the interest, you got to pay a little bit of the principal. But for years and years and years, most people were just trying to pay the interest on the principal, and you stayed in debt the rest of your life. So the Bible says that the debtor is slave to the lender, and say amen if you understand what that's all about. I'm going to teach you how to get out of that, but I'm also going to teach younger people how to be able to make sure that when you do reach the age of retirement, okay, if you stop driving so fast and stop living a reckless life, okay, that you'll be able to have probably in the neighborhood of $600,000-$700,000 to $1 million sitting in your account because of the time value of money and Rule 72. Never forget that, okay? It's free advice. I'm not a financial planner. I majored in business administration with a major in accounting, but God called me right out of college. And instead of following my family in CPA firms and becoming a lawyer and stuff like that, at 24 years old, I gave my heart to Jesus. And even though I graduated with high honors in it, I do it as a hobby. But not only as a hobby, I help entrepreneurs get their act together and especially people to get out of debt. So with that as a preamp, before we even get into that, we want to just review a little bit what we talked about last week and the idea of setting goals. And without a goal, goal is like a roadmap. And like I said last week, if you want to go to Ohio and you just tell me, I don't need a map. I'm just going to kind of like follow my instincts, okay? About 3 years later, you might hit, Florida, if you're blessed, okay? But without a map, you're not going to just get there. It's a lot faster and a lot easier if you have a map or at least a GPS system or if you know where north, south, east, and west is. Now, I love the water, so therefore, I understand where north, south, east, and west, because when you're in the middle of the ocean, and before there were these things called GPSs and all these other things like that, we used to have to use a compass. And without a compass, you have no idea where you're going unless you can read the stars, the celestial stars, or during the daytime, you can follow the sun. Okay, but other than that, you're in trouble. All right? So therefore, setting goals is extremely important, not only if you want to get your direction right, but also the direction of your life, especially when you're dealing with financial goals. How many people would like to maybe be able to one day, buy a new car? Raise your hand. Okay, everybody under 40 just said that. We who are older than 40, we could care less. As long as it runs, that's it. Okay, that's it. Okay? I don't even care what color it is anymore. You know, it's like, because I can dream I'm driving somebody else's car. That's not envy. I can just dream. I go, wow, that's a real nice car. You see what I mean? And then when I ask, how do you pay a month for that? Oh, $1,000 a month. I go, that's a nice car. I'm glad you're paying the payment, and I'm enjoying just watching it in front of me driving. Praise God. Because when you're inside of a car, you really don't know what's on the outside. You do know what's on the inside. But you get what I'm saying. The fact is that goals are extremely important to make. And we said last week, and let's just review the first four. Number one, some goals are worth waiting and working for. Remember, we talked about Jacob, who worked 14 years to be able to get the woman that he loved, Rachel. The first 7 years he worked, and his future father-in-law deceived him. And on the wedding night, he switched it with the older daughter, Leah. And he wakes up in the morning and realizes, I just married not the woman of my dreams, but the woman that I didn't even love at all. So the father goes, oh, you forgot. We have a custom here in our country that you got to marry out off the older one first. But you can have Rachel. You work for me another 7 years. Now, let me tell you something. That's either love or stupidity on which side of the coin you're looking at it at. But this man was greatly in love with Rachel. And he waited 14 years. And like we said last week, some guys can't wait 6 months and 8 months, okay, to be honor the woman today. But it's a different society, a different place that we're living in, a different landscape. But love is love when it comes to biblical kind of love. And he set a goal, and he said, you know what, 14 years, that's my goal. I'm going to work. I'm not going to complain about it. And he did get the woman of his dreams, Rachel, at the end of 14 years. So number one, some goals are worth waiting and working for. Number two, don't leave God out of your goals. Don't leave him out of your goals. Because if you set goals that are out of God's will, you might be able to even fulfill your goal in getting what you have, but you might not be able to enjoy it. You really might not be able to. For example, I'll give you a good example. My father was a good man in the sense that he was loyal, faithful. He worked for General Electric for his whole time, I think 30 or 40 years. When he retired, they basically forced him out because a new generation raised up and he was the higher salary. And you know the story, if you're in jobs where you got a high salary, they try to get rid of the older people. Make a long story short, my father was the type of individual that when he was younger was just a man of honor, and he worked for General Electric. And when the Japanese were coming into the United States big time, when they were hitting their industrial revolution, they started to want to compete with the Americans, and they had great products. And the Phillips Company had sent recruiters around, and my father was one of three installation specialists in the United States of America working for GE. He was one of the top rated installation medical systems engineers. By the way, he was self-taught. He never went to engineering college or anything else like that, but he was one of the top guys. He had the whole Northeast corridor. He had engineers, architects working under him. Make a long story short, out of the three, two of them left and went with Phillips because they offered them twice the amount of money, all kinds of benefits. And my father was off at first because he was the best, and he said, no. He said, I'm loyal to General Electric. I've been with them since 1946 after I got out of the service, and I would not do that to him. And his friend said, you're stupid. What are you doing? This, that. And make a long story short, he left. He said, because of I'm loyal to them, and he didn't leave. Of course, what was his promotion, you know, like 20 years later? They forced him out. And it was a very sad thing. But my father was an honorable man. But this is what he lived by. He says, listen, when you live by honor and your word, God hears that. That's a goal that God sets. Let your yeses be yes and your noes be no. And he says, and I don't regret the decision, whatever. And I remember I was a little boy. I says, I do. We could have been living in a mansion today, Dad. You know, he said, no, it's the principle. One of the guys who had left and followed this pursuit, he wasn't necessarily that honorable guy. And he said, listen, I am not going to live by that. Because he believed that when you are not honorable, then what happens is there's a hole that's placed in your pocket. No matter what you get, you can't enjoy it. That's why don't leave God out of your goals. Wherever your treasure is, Jesus said, there is your heart also. Amen? Wherever your treasure is, there is your heart. If your treasure is the will of God, Lord, not my will, but thine be done. You'll always be blessed. I told you about my life. I left a future career in, I wanted to be a CPA and then also a corporate lawyer. And I wanted to be able to go ahead and just take troubled corporations and to be able to straighten them out, but not work for the corporation, but kind of hire myself out as like a hired hand and be able to get a commission if I could turn the company around. I like those kind of challenges. But God had a different plan for my life. So when I graduated Hofstra University. God said, no, son, leave that for the work I've called you to do. And of course, I was saved, but I was waiting on God to call me to do something after Bible school. You know, you're waiting and nothing's happening. And I'm just kind of like, okay, Peter went back to fishing and I just went back to school, got my degree in accounting. And then my last year, boom, God just says, no, leave that now. Big decision. My family was upset and you've heard my testimony before. But I left it immediately. And then the church began to grow. And I can truly testify to you that in all of the years that I've been serving God, I've never been hungry, as you can tell. I'm pretty well fed. I've been able to do just about whatever I've wanted to do. Not on the scale if I was a multimillionaire, and I'm certainly not rich, but the point is that I've never gone without. I sleep well at night, and God is the rock of my salvation, and He takes care of me. Somehow everything works out. It's called the hand of God and the blessings of God. So when you're setting goals in your life, do not let God out of your goals. Because if you get your life blessed and you do the will of God, everything just falls into place. God makes sure. When you make peace with God, the Bible says even your enemies will lay down. They don't even bother you. And that's just the way it is. When your ways please the Lord, and there's no better way to please the Lord than to fulfill whatever His goal is for your life. Say amen if it makes any kind of sense to you. Number three, align your goals with God's. And Jesus said, Father, not my will, but yours be done. That's my favorite prayer every day. Jim's been praying that because I turned him on to it. You know, it's a very simple prayer. I don't have a list of 50,000 prayers to pray for my own life. I just kind of like group it all into one. I like Jesus simplifying everything. He even could take the Ten Commandments and simplify them down to two. Love the Lord your God with all of your heart, all of your mind, all of your strength, and then love your neighbor as yourself. He reduced it down to two. Love God first, love your neighbor as yourself. Vertical first, horizontal. But you can't have vertical without horizontal because there are two, and two is the number of witness. So I like the idea of being able to just align my goals with God's. And how do I do that? It's very simple. I just say, Father, not my will be done. In other words, your will is your chooser. And we choose things every day, and God made us like Himself. You have the ability to choose. For example, some of you after the church service today are going to say, where would you like to go to eat? Okay, I want Chinese. No, I want Italian. Okay, some of you are going to fast food it maybe. I want Wendy's. No, I want Chick-fil, or I want, what are some of the other ones? McDonald's and Burger King, you know. Some of you are going, ugh, that's garbage food. But don't knock people who liked it. This is America, okay? It's a free country, okay? And don't knock it, especially if you've already eaten it before, praise God, especially when you're younger. When we get older, we can't eat that stuff anymore as much. So we go for the good stuff, gooey Chinese food, you know. And I love General Chow's chicken. It is like this, there's something about the goo. It's the goo in there. It's very sweet. They got it down. They really do. And that's an American food. I heard they don't even necessarily serve that in Chinatown unless to Americans. But we like that. Okay, and we're spoiled in America because we got so much of this stuff. So listen, align your goals with God's goals. Just make it simple. Father, not my will. Lord, please don't let me do all my will. I give you power of attorney over my life and guide me. Shut doors. I tell God, God, if this is not your will, shut the door. I give you permission. Why do we have to do that? Because our will a lot of times is to do whatever we want to do. And we make bad choices. I see people making bad choices of mates. I see people making bad choices in school. They get degrees, you know, in subjects that they're never going to be able to find a job. And you know, the only thing got at the end of some of these private colleges today is a $100,000 bill, you know. And a guy becomes I'm not going to name a profession. I might, you know, upset some of you. But I got news for you right now. If you love history, that's not the subject to be able to get a job. Okay, just buy some books and read them. It's a lot cheaper than spending $100,000 in a private university to get a history degree where there are no jobs for, okay? Now, there are certain jobs you can get, like, a dual language, like speaking Spanish and English and teaching Spanish to English people, or chemistry, you want to major in that? Jobs for that. Mathematics, yeah, you can become a teacher and, you know, work 20 years and live high on the hog off the government, although there might not be any money left in 20 years in this place, but I don't want to get into that right now. Praise God about the national debt and everything. But you know what I mean. You've got to align yourself with God's goals. And when you do that, you can rest assured that there'll be peace in your heart. I sleep very well at night. Okay, and I'm a pastor, so I have the lives of many individuals that I'm concerned about. But I sleep very well, and I always kid with Jess when we're in bed. I say, Jess, I don't think I can sleep. She goes, yeah, and then she starts to count. By the time she hits 10, I'm gone, okay? I am gone, praise the Lord. That's it. I sleep really well. And I wake up in the morning maybe, 4:35, and I just lay in bed praising God and feel the peace of God on my life. And I didn't always have that. And some of you don't have that now, but you can have it when you align yourself with God's will. Say amen. Okay, and then 4 was the summary of last week. God might not lead you on the shortest path to fulfill your goal. And remember the children of Israel. They get out of Egypt, cross the Red Sea. They're all excited about it. It's only 11 days to be able to go ahead to get to the promised land. 11 days. It took 40 years to get there. 11 days. And one of the reasons why God said, I'm not going to do that, is because when you face the problems that you're going to have to face, such as the enemy that might come against you, you might go ahead and chicken out, basically, I'm paraphrasing, and want to go back to Egypt. And for us Christians, when we set goals, a lot of times they're not goals, they're dreams. Does anyone know a dreamer? They got these big dreams, and you ask them, well, how are you going to get there? Well, it's like I just believe it's going to happen. Yeah, you can believe all you want to that you're going to be a heart surgeon, okay? You can believe all you want to. And unless you go to school, get your medical degree, and sign off, I'm not going to you if I had a heart problem, that's for sure. It reminds me of Ed Norton in that show, The Honeymooners, when he was pretending he was a doctor. And the other surgeons are going, where did you practice? Oh, I don't have to practice. I know how to be a doctor, No, you want somebody who's been qualified. In other words, they reach goals. And you don't become a doctor by just saying you want to become a doctor. That's what 4- and 5-year-olds say when I want to be the president of the United States, or I want to be a fireman, I want to be this, that, and the other thing. No, if you don't set goals, you're never going to get there. Without a roadmap, you're just not going to get there. They're just pipe dreams. But if you're willing to sit down and set goals, and we'll talk about those, long-term goals become nothing but dreams without short-term goals that are set down on paper. I say on paper so they remind you all the time. And it's step 1, step 2, step 3, step 4, step 5, step 6. And when you do that, you don't have to worry about the long-term goal turning into just a dream. It becomes a reality and hard work. And on the way to long-term goals, there's all kinds of obstacles. We'll talk about those. So today, we begin with number 5. And that's don't stop trusting God as you near your goals. The children of Israel, Numbers chapter 14, verses 5 through 9. Then Moses and Aaron fell face down in front of the whole Israelite assembly gathered there. Joshua, son of Nun, and Caleb, son of Jephunneh, who were among those who had explored the land, tore their clothes and said to the entire Israelite assembly, the land we passed through and explored is exceedingly good. And if the Lord is pleased with us, he'll lead us into this land, a land flowing with milk and honey, and will give it to us. Only do not rebel against the Lord. And do not be afraid of the people of the land, because we will swallow them up. Their protection is gone, but the Lord is with us. Do not be afraid of them. Now, let me give you some history background here. The Spirit of the Lord tells 12 tribes to send representatives into spy out the land. 10 of them come back and give a bad report. And this is their bad report. The land is flowing with milk and honey, but the giants in the land, we're like grasshoppers. We're never going to be able to do this. Joshua and Caleb, have a different spirit, the Bible says, within them. Okay, because everybody's panicking. They all want to go back to Egypt. Oh, why did God do this? Why, Moses, how could you do this to us? This, that, and the other thing. They want to go back into Egypt. They want to go back into the ways of the world. They don't want to go by faith. They want to walk the way of just the comfort zone of humanity, which leads always out of the will of God. They couldn't trust God. But Caleb and Joshua said, no, wait a minute, hold it. Yeah, there's giants in the land, but God's with us. So therefore, we can deal with this. In the land flowing with milk and honey, do not be afraid. Their protection is gone. But the Lord is with us. Don't be afraid. So don't stop trusting God just because the way gets a little bit tough and you have a lot of individuals that are around you saying, don't do it. I get back to my family. My family, we're a very loving family, but my father thought I was a little out of my mind. You know, I left the music industry. I was a very successful New York musician back in the old days. Okay. I made a very good living. I was never famous, but I worked in some of the biggest, with the biggest agencies in New York as a lead singer and a sax player, not a keyboardist. And I left that when I got saved. And then I go to Bible school. My father thought I was nuts. You what? You're going to leave everything? Now you're going to be a monk in a monastery somewhere? No, I'm not going to be a monk, Dad. He says, how are you going to earn a living? He said, I am just going to make learning about God my full-time job. And you heard me say before, you ain't doing it here. In other words, I said, no, Dad, I'm just going to trust God. He goes, trust him all you want, but you're not living here. Without a job, you're out of here. Okay, and I didn't live there. And I went to Bible school. And graduated that, get out of that, and God still did not speak to me. But I knew I was called to the ministry. So everything around me, my parents is saying, my brother's saying, come on, son, Rob, just finish your degree in accounting. And, you want to be honest? Be a banker. He said, because in a bank, auditors check everything over every year. So therefore, you're so like right is right and wrong is wrong and there's no gray areas, then be a banker. Work at a bank somewhere. This way you can be an honest accountant. It didn't work out. Why? Well, I got my degree. But then God said, leave it. It's the work I have prepared for you. And I said, okay, God. And sure enough, the church began to grow. And I started to witness more and more to people. See, my goal was always, Father, not my will, but thine be done. And I can remember during some tough times, especially when I was in Hofstra University, studying for final exams, wondering, what the heck am I doing? I graduated Bible school. Now I'm going to become a CPA. I'm still waiting on God's will. And meanwhile, everyone around me is trying to kind of like say, you can still do God's will, but just take the CPA exam. Back then, you could take it after 4 years. And I had studied so much for it. And I said, no. I'm not going to take the exam. And my family thought I was crazy. But I was always praying, Father, not my will, but thine be done. And the church began to grow. Make a long story short, for those who are hearing this story for the first time, within about a year after that, the church began to grow and grow and grow. And my father got saved. My brother ends up getting saved. My whole family got saved. And they saw that the hand of God was on me. And my father even said, he said, you are a walking miracle. I'm never going to question whatever you tell God to, because I can't believe that you've actually done this. And I've never regretted it ever in my life. Never. Now I can't remember a debit from a credit and which side it is. I don't know if it's because I'm getting older. I just don't care anymore. Okay, praise the Lord. I let my wife handle that. And she studied accounting too. So therefore, it's all done. But one thing I do know is that when you are in the middle of this goal-seeking thing, and you've made some short-term goals, and you've outlined them, and you get opposition and stuff like that, if God's the center of your life, and you pray, God, if this is not your will, then take this desire away from me. Please take it away from me. Shut the door. And he doesn't shut the door, then that opposition, you know what? It's just typical opposition. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Yeah, we get opposition from without, opposition in our own thoughts and everything else like that. But you can become anything you desire to become in Jesus Christ if you start with, Father, not my will, but thine be done. Somebody out here, you're thinking about going to college and you did terrible in high school, and you're saying, I just don't have the brains for it. Can you speak? Yes. Lift the right hand. Okay. Well, for you, it would be this way. Okay. Blink your eyes. Okay. 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 Now turn around. I'm going to say 1, 2. Okay, well, I'm going to say something, and then you repeat it. Then I spin them around. I go, okay, you qualify. They go, huh? I said, you have the ability to analyze things. Who told you you were stupid? Well, my folks did, my friends, or I acted stupid in high school. Nonsense. Nonsense. Okay? Absolute nonsense. They've pushed me out of high school, but not because I was stupid. I ended up with hundreds in music. I was allowed to take college-level courses in music in ninth grade. And I was majoring in clarinet and saxophone, and I just, God had gifted me with an ear, but I was failing everything else. And I had to go talk to the school's, psychologist, and they wanted to find out, why are you so good in music and don't want... I said, it's very simple. I don't like anything else. He goes, well, that's an honest answer. He said, do you think you could do good? I said, of course I could do good. I don't see any use for it. What a stupid thing to say. Because when I did go to college, I had a lot of trouble with math. I only had an eighth grade education in math. They pushed me through elementary algebra. I got a 13 on the final, and somehow I got a 65. When I hardly even went to class. And they gave me 13 points, the teacher said, because you put your name right on the paper and got the date right. And they graduated me anyhow. It's called push them through. But it hurt me when I went to college. I had to study harder than anybody else. Because this idea of goals is so important. You have to realize that if you're going to learn, and I never took calculus, but I took algebra and trigonometry. And let me tell you, I had to work really hard at that. My brain would look at this stuff and say, what? I had to memorize formulas, and I was doing this so many hours a day, and my buddy next to me, this guy was like, he had such high grades coming out of high school. This guy forgot there were tests. Oh, there's a test today? I go, yeah. And he'd get up like a 92, and me, it's like I had to work so hard to get an 85, and this guy didn't even know there was a test that day. It's because he prepared, which leads me to this idea. You got a long-term goal? It's only going to be a dream if you don't break it into achievable short-term goals, which in mathematics, and believe me, I'm not into Common Core. I think it's absolutely insane, okay? I really do. I don't think it's a good way of teaching at all. But that's me, okay, especially in English, which I have some knowledge of because I studied it in college, and mathematics because I didn't study it in high school, but I did study it in college, and thank God Common Core is not in college. They teach math the way it should be taught. But mathematics is very simple. You don't go to algebra unless you first learn to subtract, add, multiply, and divide, right? You got to learn the basics. Those are goals, short-term goals. In any language you learn, whether it's German or whether it's French or Spanish, you have to start with the basics. You can't just go in there and expect 3 weeks to be able to go ahead and speak unless God gave you the gift of speaking in heavenly languages and normal tongues, and you can do it even though you might not understand what you're saying. There are goals to be set, but you got to be reasonable about it. So how do we get that way? I think that, and this is number 6, obedience to God is our greatest goal. And Jesus said this in Matthew chapter 5, verse 19. Anyone who breaks the one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called the least in the kingdom of God. That's pretty heavy stuff. But whoever practices and teaches these commands will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. Anyone who breaks the least of these commandments and teaches others to do so. I think of all the commandments of God that our American society and culture are violating today, and I'm saying I think they stand in judgment before Christ. See, in the universe that God created, if you believe in God, Jesus said, believe also in me. If there's a creator, he had standard principles and rules and regulations to govern the universe. Let's take it out of the supernatural realm and go down to the practical realm, the natural realm. The realm of physics, the realm of biology. He created the male and female. A male is a male, a female is a female. You don't get to choose, okay? After 24 years, you know what? I think I'm a female if you're a male. If you get confused, take your clothes off, look in the mirror with nobody else around, get a biology book out, and you can figure out what you are. That's what you are. If you start thinking that you can go ahead and make a goal of making yourself into a different species, okay, a dog or a cat or a lion or a bear, okay, you need to go back and just watch The Wizard of Oz for a while, okay, and realize that that's fantasy. Because physics are physics. They're laws. You can't violate those laws without some kind of thing happening to your life and shipwrecking. Everything that God asks us to do, he asks us to do these things so that we can have a life filled with blessings. Believe me, I came from the entertainment industry, and that's the entertainment industry is a place where you just do whatever you feel like doing. And, you know, so long as you're not hurting anybody except yourself, you should be able to do it. Unfortunately, when you hurt yourself, you're hurting somebody else, especially your family members or society. If we got to pay for the damage that you've done, okay, we got to pay for all your medical bills. We got to pay for all these things. You can do whatever you want to. Okay, you can sit on a desert island and twirl yourself into eternity for all I care. But don't make me pay for it. Because this is America and you can do whatever you want. And also, don't teach my kids that these things are normal. Don't teach my kids that they can violate the laws of physics. It has nothing to do with religion. It has to do with sanity. Okay, let's move on. So obedience to God's got to be our greatest goal. Thy word is a lamp to my feet, a light to my path. It guides me. Proverbs is a tremendous book that can keep young people out of a lot of snares of the enemy. It's filled with wisdom given to Solomon. He had more wisdom given to him than any other person except for Jesus Christ. And the reason why he got all this wisdom is because God asked him, listen, as king now, ask for anything and I'll give it to you. And boy, Solomon asked for the right thing. It's like having a genie in a bottle and it comes out of it. Even though we don't believe in that stuff and it's magic and that's not of God. But the point is, so there are a lot of people understanding this that doesn't understand what the Bible's all about. God's not a genie. But I'm telling you something. If God says, listen, ask me for anything and I'm going to give it to you, better think twice before you ask. Because with God, it's not three wishes. It's the first thing you ask for. So what does Solomon say? He says, Lord, I only want the wisdom to be able to lead your people and be a good king. So what does God say? Because you didn't ask for gold and silver and all the things that other humans ask for, I'm going to give you more gold and silver. I'm going to give you wisdom like no one on the earth has ever had before. And God did that. Now, all the blessings ended up kind of like, not the wisdom, but all of the material blessings start getting him into trouble. But all of the people and all queens and kings would come and listen to Solomon as he'd open his mouth and the Spirit of the Lord would just pour out wisdom about the universe and making so much sense. He makes philosophers' heads spin with the logic and reasoning that came out for him in such simplicity. I love it. It's like some of the things he said, you know, like he when he was miserable because of all his sin and stuff like that, his wisdom was still there. And he said, vanity of vanities, said the preacher man. Everything is just vain because he was backslidden. But the wisdom is pouring out of his mouth. He goes, think of it. The eye is never satisfied with seeing. All the rivers flow into the ocean and it's never full. And these are all just illustrations of what's going on inside of his own heart. He's saying what's crooked cannot be made straight. And then at the end, he says, after everything's been heard and said, fear God and keep his commandments because God will bring every act into judgment. Now, for us in the New Testament, the judgment for all of our sins is on the cross. So that's taken care of. But the principle still remains. What are you asking God for in your life? I'm telling you, the best way is just say obedience to God. Father, not my will, but yours be done. That lines you up with heaven itself. And the hand of God comes upon your life. The blessings of God come on your life. And you live a blessed life. Say amen if that makes sense. How about believers? How about a church and the goals of a church, what they're supposed to be? Let's look at Romans. This is number 7. We only got one more after this. Romans chapter 12 and verses 4 to 8. Just as each of us has one body and many members, and these members do not have all the same function, verse 5, so in Christ, we who are many form what? One body. And each member belongs to all the others. We have different gifts according to the grace given us. If a man's gift is prophesying, let him use it in proportion to his faith. If it is serving, let him serve. If it is teaching, let him teach. If it is encouraging, let him encourage. You mean there's a gift of encouragement? Sure. Do you ever meet some people that they're just encourages? You know, you find out that all hell is breaking loose somewhere, and it looks like the ship is going down, and you find an encourager. Yeah, but I think everything's going to work out. And everybody looks at him. Are you going to be kidding me? It's time to jump ship. Well, the water's only 3/4 of the way up in the boat. Encourager, trying to encourage people. You see? When everybody is willing to go ahead and just let this person go because you can't deal with them no more. There's always one with got the gift of encouragement comes along and say, can we give him one more chance? One more chance! He's had already 498. But Jesus said, forgive 499 times. Could you give him one more chance? Ah, you got to spoil this thing. That's the gift of encouragement. It just believes. Love believes all things. It never fails and you never give up. I think I need a little bit more of that gift. How many out here say amen to that one? Praise God. I'm working on it, though. Praise God. Hey, I used to just run people out after 3 times, okay? 3 strikes, you're out. I used to use the old umpire thing. You're out! 3 times! And then I read Jesus says 499. I go, oh, my gosh. And even 499 times, Jesus was just exaggerating to the point to make the point that it's not the amount of times, it's the idea that if somebody asks for forgiveness, you must forgive or your sins remain. So we have different gifts in verse 6, according to the grace given us. And then in verse 8, if it's encouraging, let him encourage. If it is contributing to the needs of others, in other words, giving generosity, you know. I've been getting that gift more and more, and I really enjoy that gift. Because when you do good, you, I don't think everybody's convinced. When you do good, you feel good. When you do bad, you. The Bible says, woe to those who call good evil and evil good. You got a lot of people today saying evil things are good. Okay. Just because society believes it's good. I can tell you never studied history. By the way, I love history. I study history now. Never read a book when I was in high school, okay, except Clef Notes. For those old enough to remember Clef Notes, I still failed the English exam. And I had the Clef Notes. I had the book. But it was a dream that I was going to read it before the English test. And it was only a dream. I did not fulfill the short-term goal of reading the book first. I guessed. And my English teacher really liked me. She really did. She said, you are really strange. I said, thank you. I'm a musician. She goes, that explains it. She goes, why do you like music and hate everything? I said, I don't hate anything else. I see no use for it. And what an idiotic statement. Because when I went to college, I realized that English and history, so great. Because if you do not understand the past, you're condemned many times to repeat it. I love political history. I love economic history. Oh, sociological history. I am a frustrated marine archaeologist. You have to look that up in the dictionary. I'm not going to go into it right now. I just love discovering things. That's why I wanted to major in auditing in college. I love the idea of being able to discover something. You know, ah, wow. You said your books are in order. Oh, naughty, naughty, naughty. And since I was a Christian, you couldn't buy me off. I would have told the truth. Probably would have never got hired again by another corporation. Hey, don't hire this guy. This guy's too honest. He should be a banker. But anyhow, last goal. God's ultimate goal for us, number 8, is found in Romans chapter 8, verse 29. Look at this. For those God foreknew, he predestined to be conformed to the likeness of his son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. Let's break it down. For those God foreknew. What do you mean foreknew? That's a word that we don't use every day. You don't go around to your friends saying, hey, do you foreknew anything today? No, in other words, knew beforehand. Well, how could God knew something before it happened? Simple, because God is outside of time and space. You see, he wrote the whole book, and he knows the ending. That's the book of Revelation. But you are only a chapter in the book. You might be in the later chapters of your book. In other words, all of us have a certain number of chapters. Some people shut their lives down very early from stupid mistakes, driving too fast, getting drunk, doing drugs, just destroying yourself and not listening to the wisdom of others. You're living pipe dreams. You're talking about getting rich, but meanwhile you do nothing to be able to change your circumstances at all. Your mother and father goes, yeah, I heard that before. Yeah, I heard that before. And then they buy a parrot and they have the parrot memorize that because they're sick of telling you it. And they have the parrot every time they see you. Yeah, I heard that before. But God predestines us, whom he foreknew. What's this word, foreknew? He knows before, because he's outside. He knows the beginning and the end of your life. He knows who's going to choose him and who's not going to choose him. It's magnificent. It's like, and God, because he foreknows, when the message of the gospel goes forth to you, you say, well, I didn't hear it yet. You're hearing it right now, and you're responsible for it. So if you choose Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior to set you free from sins, he writes your name in his book of life if you're willing to walk to the teachings of Jesus. And they're not very difficult, but it is a denial process. You must learn to deny yourself, take up your cross daily, and follow after him. Trust me, you can do it. Because I don't think anybody was a bigger sinner than I was. The only thing I never did was murder somebody. But I actually got very close to it many times. I think it was God that prevented me from doing those things. Was I the chiefest of sinners? No, Paul murdered Christians. He put his hearty approval on putting Christians to death. In fact, when he got up to heaven, who was the one he had apologized to, kinda? Stephen, remember the deacon? Yeah, because he was there and they were laying their cloaks at the feet of Paul, who was Saul back then. And then he becomes the Apostle Paul. He has a meeting with Jesus, just like you can have a meeting with God. My point is that we all start out as unbelievers. Oh, we might start out in a church and you might go to church or you might think you have some kind of relationship with God or some celestial being in the far off hereafter somewhere. Okay, you might believe in all kinds of things in the spiritual world, but do you really know the creator of all the spiritual beings that you think exist? Do you know the Holy One of Israel? Have you met Messiah, the Savior of the world? And that's the key point. You see, so those who he foreknew, he predestines. And that word predestined, I love it. It comes from a Greek word. It means basically set up the boundaries around the individual. That's why some of you are still alive today. How many people will admit that some of the things that happened in your life up till now, you should have been dead, but somehow, miraculously, you lived? Yeah. Well, all of us have angels around us. They're ministering spirits sent out for the elect. In other words, as a Christian, you can't leave this earth until it's your time. That makes me sleep at night. Very well. I'm not afraid of the future at all. Not at all. My wife wants me to live a real long time. And I would like to live a long time for the people that I'm discipling and the people that I love. But when God calls me home, it's a promotion to glory. But don't help me get there sooner. And God says, son, don't help me take you home quicker. By the way, either you eat or the way you drive or some of the choices that you make. I don't make those choices no more. But I'll admit, when I was younger, I had a bad temper. And that temper drove anger. And that anger made me do very irrational things. But God's delivered me from all of those things. It's kind of like the valleys have come up and the mountains have come down. And it's kind of like a highway. It's kind of like life is like eyesight. Okay? If you were born with 20/20, and a lot of people weren't, but if you're born with 20/20 vision, things are going real fine. You see so clearly, but it also reflects in your critical analysis in your brain. You ever noticed it's mostly the younger that we are, the more critical we usually are about things and we are opinionated about everything. Okay? Your eyesight's like 20/20. You got 20/20 criticism. It's just like you got an opinion about everything. Then the older we get, especially when you hit after 40 years old, things don't mean the same anymore. They really don't. Whereas you see a lot of younger people, they're all upset over something. And the people over 40, yeah, they're just grabbing another hamburger. Yeah, that's terrible, yeah. Don't you even care? Well, I did when I was young, right now. What do I care? I care about if there's ketchup left over for my hamburger. That's all I care about right now. Ha, you don't care about nothing. But all of a sudden, you notice you go to the doctor for your eyes. The first time I noticed it when I was like 41 years old. And I remember I went because I wasn't reading so, you know, good with my regular eyesight. And the optometrist that I went to, she was just newly out of school. And I said, what do you think my problem is? She goes, you're getting older. You know, for a 26-year-old to tell somebody 41 they're getting older, that's an insult. But I didn't insult her at all. Like, I just kind of like laughed. But in my head, it's like, what? But then I realized, you know what? The same thing started happening to me. I wasn't really caring about so many things going on outside of my family and my life. I wasn't trying to solve the problems of the world anymore. It's kind of like my eyesight. It's like my eyesight was kind of like getting to the place where it was a little dim here and there on certain issues. I look at it as being the valleys were coming up and the mountains laid low. And the most important things in life was family, friends, but not in that order. God's will first, family, and friends. After all, what does your life really consist of? And as we close this whole section on goal setting, and we're going to go into, next week, we're going to go into managing, okay, your finances in a brief summary of it, but then we're going to zero in on such things as budgeting and such things as wrestling your expenses down. I'll give you a preview, not next week, but the week after. Nobody's going to see it but you. But one of the requirements will be, if you want to, if you really want me to help you, I'm free. I'm your pastor, okay? But I know what I'm talking about when it comes about these things because God allowed me to be able to study it for over 40 years, and even though I don't practice it, I know pretty much a lot about budgeting. But I'm going to show you how to be able to wrestle these things down. Why? So that you don't have to work so hard and be able to go ahead and not be worried so much about money, because worrying about money is an idol, and it takes your attention off of God, who should be number one in your life. Amen? I'm going to teach you on how to be extremely happy with a peanut butter and jelly sandwich. And also lobster tails, if you like them. But either one should give you the same satisfaction. It just depends upon where you're at in your heart when it comes to goals. God's number one in your life. That's all I care about. And that's all God cares about. Amen? I tell you what, I'm going to leave this scripture because this is important. And I promise this is the last one. So stand to your feet. That'll be a real good sign that I'm done, if you're standing to your feet. But put up Philippians chapter 3, verses 12 to 14. I want to leave you with a rah-rah cheer because this is the Apostle Paul. You know, setting goals, okay? And this is what Paul said. Not that I have already attained all of this, but have already been made perfect, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. And brothers, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind, straining toward what is ahead, I press on towards the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. That should be the ultimate goal of our lives. I want to give you a chance right now. Let's bow our hearts and bow our heads and close your eyes. And just listen to me for a moment. If you've never made your peace with God, Jesus said, go into all and preach this message. Those who believe will be saved. Those who don't will be damned. This is what Jesus said. And what is the message? That God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him would not perish but have everlasting life. God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but through Jesus, the world could be saved. If you've never received Christ into your heart and said, Jesus, forgive me for all of my sins. Help me, Lord, to be a real Christian. I want you to pray this prayer with me. Anyone that here is coming back to Christ or not sure of where you're at in your relationship to God, just pray the prayer too. And if it's the prayer of your heart, the Holy Spirit will seal this day and write it in heaven in the name's book of life that this day you made a serious commitment. Say it with me right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, forgive me for all my sins. I believe that Jesus died on the cross, took the penalty of all my sins, and on the third day he rose from the dead. Save my soul and grant me eternal life, O Lord. Help me to live as a real Christian. Help me to obey your word, to read the Bible so I can know what your will is. In Jesus' name I thank you. Holy Spirit, lead me and guide me into all truth. In Jesus' name, amen.